Hello, welcome at another Learning to Bank talk. Yeah, we're talking about how in the text kernel we've implemented Learning to Bank in our search system, which is like a faceted search system, and how we overcame some obstacles in translating the theory into practice. So let me first tell something about the search system that we use. It's a job-to-person search system, or person-to-job. And it's a typical example of faceted search. As you can see on the left, you have this bar of facets where you can filter on different fields like city, years of experience, job title. And on the top you have the query, and then you have the results which are ranked in a specific way. And if you hover over a certain result, you can see how well it matches the query. So in this case, the query is based on the vacancy, and the documents are all based on CVs. So we also have a system where which we can automatically generate a query from a vacancy. And this usually results in a relatively large query, again with a lot of different dimensions, as you can see in this example. For example, we have full text terms, but we also have query parts related to education, to language, to less employer. It's also important to mention that here the colors of the query parts represent if the query part item is a must have, should have, or could have. Because usually when you search for people for a certain job, you don't really want somebody that fits all criteria exactly, because you're never going to find such perfect candidate usually. You just want somebody that matches most of your criteria, and especially the more important ones. So we also have pair result and this match indicator, and there you can see how many of these query part items or facet items actually match your CV or document. So this is a typical example of faceted search, where you have multiple explicit and independent dimensions, and you let users refine the search by choosing values. This is very common in e-commerce, for example, where you can filter on brand, price, product, category, color. But as I said already, in our system, it's kind of different from e-commerce in the sense that we have many should-have clauses, and it's not just a bunch of filters. So let's briefly go over how search results are normally scored. So usually you use some sort of term frequency-based metric like BM25 or TF-IDF. And then in case of faceted search, you also have a bunch of faceted weights which you can multiply with the scores for each of these facets, so that you get sort of a weighted score where some facets are considered more relevant than others. So let's now look into some of the tuning requests we get from our customers as a search development team. For example, people are saying that, if I search on the skill field and I search for the term Java, I also want candidates that have Java in their job title field to be ranked higher. So this is an example of basically cross-field dependencies. Another example could be education will be a less important match the more years of experience a candidate has. A rather intuitive example again. And finally, one example is we should weight location matches less when finding candidates in IT, because people that work in IT are known to often easily relocate. For example, after I finish this talk, I'm sure you all want to move to Amsterdam to work with us. So enter Learning to Rank, because we can use that technology to solve these issues, right? So briefly summarizing Learning to Rank, it's just all about learning a parameterized ranking model that optimizes the ranking order. And you can, the idea is to also relearn it for personalization or preference change. So, one very simple way of learning to rank that you can probably already think of right now is just to tune the facet weights that we saw earlier. So you can do an exhaustive search over the space of all possible facet weight combinations. And this way you can find the optimal weight setting. And this is something we actually did. And it worked. It improved our retrieval by 6% relative to the baseline, where the baseline was the default facet weight setting. According to the energy G metric, which is like a retrieval performance metric where higher energy G is better, simply speaking. And then you end up basically with with the weight factor, right? So you have the factor with the scores of your different facet fields, which you can multiply with your optimal facet weights, and then you get the new score. But this obviously has some limitations. Using this method, you cannot consider the interdependency of facet field dimensions, and you cannot take into account the actual content of fields, but only the match indicator. So we cannot actually learn a rule like, okay, if I search for the computer skill Java, I want people to also have Java in their job title field to be ranked higher. That's not possible with this approach. So our learning objectives when we did learning to rank were basically, okay, take into account these facet field content and also model these facet field interdependencies. So I'm just going to give a really brief overview of learning to rank and also related a bit to how we implemented it in our system here. So basically, learning to rank is just machine learning from user feedback, right? As input, you have a set of query where each query has a list of assessed documents belonging to it. So each document has this relevance indication that you have gotten from feedback somehow. So there's a difference between explicit feedback and implicit feedback. You also see how we implemented this in our system. Explicit feedback is something that you require some explicit user action. In our system, we simply have a thumbs up or thumbs down. And implicit feedback is based on user click actions, like saving a result or exporting it or clicking on it. It's easier to gather, but you need way more of it because it's also way less reliable. So okay, we end up with a set of query and list of assessed documents where each document has a relevance label from feedback. So what we called relevance indication in the previous slide, we now call relevance label. And yeah, in this case, we have binary relevance, so just plus one or minus one. And so this is then fed to the algorithm, and the learning to rank algorithm just learns how to combine the query and document content to optimize the ordering considering these relevance labels. So it consists basically of two stages. First, you do the feature extraction, then you have the machine learning algorithm or the ranking algorithm. And this results in a ranking model. And the output is then this ranking model. And then when you want to score a document of which you don't know the relevance label, you give the query and the document. First, you let it go to the feature extraction pipeline that you already had. And then you give it to this ranking model, and then you get a score. So when you use learning to rank in your own system, you do this for all the documents for a query, and you can then reorder these documents based on these scores. So this is basically how we, overview how we used in our system. So you have a query. And the query goes to an index, and you get a set of return documents. And then we have a result splitter module that basically sends the top K documents, for example, the top 100, to go to this feature extraction. Each of them applies the ranking model on them, and then you get the top K documents re-ranked back. And these are then prepended to the rest of the documents. And in contrast to these to earlier talks by Doug and Jigo, we don't really, so we have the re-ranking outside of the core search engine. We now use Elasticsearch, but that's not, that doesn't make like a principal difference here. So let's look on how we can do like this feature extraction part of the pipeline according to the literature. So according to literature and learning to rank, each query document pair is represented by a multi-dimensional feature vector, and each dimension of the vector is a feature indicating how relevant or important the document is with respect to the query, right? So in many LTR papers, what is used as this feature is a match indicator based on these similarity models present in search engines, such as TF-IDF, BM25, language model, etc. Yeah, so this is, these metrics are basically used as sort of a match indicator between the whole query and the whole document. So the query and the document are basically seen as it's a bag of terms. But bag of terms or bag of words is basically not how you do faceted search, right? Because let's say we have a query where we search for a person with the job of a software engineer with the skills data mining and Java, who lives in Amsterdam and speaks English. Then if we would ignore all the facets and treat them all, treat both the query and documents as bag of words, we would get the same score for a candidate that really matches the criteria to the left and one that doesn't match the criteria to the right. So usually, in the facet search, of course, you split the document and the query up in these facet fields so that you have a correct match. And that way, you can get a higher score for the person who's matched in the correct facet fields with respect to the facet fields of the query. So the thing is that so we also want to base our features on that, right? We want to say we want to have a feature per facet field. But the thing is that in that case, it doesn't really matter if you use TF-IDF or BM25, because these only really differ in how they deal with like term frequency of the terms in that field in the document, or the length of the field, or the collection frequency. And in our case, this all doesn't really matter. We just want all these metrics will basically measure the same thing. So what we do is just we, as a feature, we just say, okay, how often, how many of the query part items of that facet in the query are present in the document. So in this case, for this document, one out of one job titles from the query are matched. One out of two skills from the query are matched. Zero out of one locations of the query are matched, and one out of one language of the query are matched for the document. And so this way you end up with a relatively simple feature vector that's also not dependent on your index, because it's not dependent on the collection frequency of certain terms. So let's now see how we can use this in a ranking model. So linear. So the obvious choice, if you start learning to rank, seems to be linear models. These are used in many papers, and also so they're relatively prominent in the documentation for Solar's LTR plugin. So they seem like the obvious first choice. And this is basically a linear model, right? So you have this, you end up with this this weight vector, which you multiply with your vector of feature values, and that way you get a score for your document. So what would happen if we put these features that we talked about earlier in this feature vector, and we multiply it with a weight vector, and that could be a ranking model, right? And then we get a certain score. But then we get back to the original limitations of tuning facet field weight, which is that we cannot consider interdependency of facet field dimensions, and we also cannot take into account the actual content of fields only the match indicators. So yeah, this is basically the same as doing an exhaustive search for the optimal facet field weight, and doesn't bring us any further in satisfying or tuning requests, like, okay, can I learn that matching on education becomes less important as the number of years of experience of a candidate increases. Yeah, so to come back to these objectives again, these are the kind of dependencies we want to learn, right? We want to learn that, if you search for a skill in this field and the skill occurs in another field, they should get a boost, or yeah, education should be less important the more years of experience a candidate has. And for this, we need to take into account the facet field content and model the facet field interdependencies. So how do we take into account the facet field content? Basically by constructing our features in a bit more sophisticated way. So we have in our model, we have like categorical features and interval features. And these categorical features are, for example, if you have five possible job classes, because we have this whole ontology of job classes, job groups, etc. So let's say we have five possible job classes that can occur in a document. Then we use this one of k encoding. So we put the one when a certain job class is present and a zero otherwise. And of course, we also have interval features, which are just based on a single numerical value. For example, the number of years of experience. And we can just put it in the vector directly after normalizing a bit. So this way, we do not only take into account these query document match features, but also document features and query features. As I said, these can be categorical, in which case they are denoting in our system a certain skill, or a certain job class or job category, or they can be interval-based, such as years of experience or location distance from the location in the query. So let's say that, okay, we have now these cool features and we plug it in this vector, and then we apply this linear model to it. Will we then get a better system? The answer is no, because there's still no way here to model these interdependencies, right? The only thing that this model can learn is that documents with a certain job class always need to be scored higher or always need to be scored lower. There's no dependency with the query whatsoever. So it is not going to be a very smart model. And the solution, as I already hinted at in previous talks, is to use a nonlinear model, a ranking model. For example, based on nonlinear neural networks, nonlinear SVM, or decision trees, which are inherently nonlinear. Here I should say that it should be like a learning to rank model or algorithm. You cannot just use any decision tree or SVM model from scikit-learn or whatever and just apply it to your ranking function, because it has to be a learn to rank algorithm, because these are specifically designed to optimize the pairwise or listwise cost function that really optimizes the ranking. So you cannot just use like a normal regression or a classification model. So we also use this decision tree model. I will very briefly describe how a decision tree sort of works. So in this example, we have the field experience years, for example, from the document. And the blue, you can see this is sort of a distribution, right, where from left to right, where the left values are, for example, zero experience years, and to the right they have like 40 experience years. And then the blue bars are documents that need to be ranked higher, and the red bars represent documents that need to be ranked lower. Now, what is our decision tree works is that it tries to find the optimal split in this on the horizontal axis of this distribution, so that all the ideally like all the blue ones fall to one direction and the red ones to the other direction or the other way around. But basically, that in the end result, the documents that fall in a certain leaf are as pure as possible, so no red mixed with blues. So in this case, you see that okay, it finds a split in the middle of the number of experience years, and then for the documents that do have that, it finds another split, namely based on if the job class in the document is management. If not, well, they need to be ranked higher, and if so, then they need to be ranked slightly lower. So this is like a very simplified example of how a decision tree could look like in our system. It's important to note that this is like automatically learned, and it's just an example of how it could look like. So in this case, we see that, okay, if a job class of the document is IT, and if the location doesn't match, give it a score of 1. If the job class is not IT and location doesn't match, give it a score of 0.3. And these scores are basically the final relevance of the document. So the higher the score, the higher it needs to be ranked in the end by the system. So as you can see, this basically represents the tuning request we talked about earlier, namely that we should weight location matches less when finding candidates in IT. Because as I said, if the job class of a document is IT, then if the location doesn't match, it's ranked, it's giving a higher score than if the document is not IT. But also if the location does match, it's giving a slightly lower score than when the job class of the document is not IT. There's another example, of the other. There's another example decision tree of the example learning objective. Like, okay, if I search for skilled Java, I want candidates that also have Java in their job title field to be rated higher. So you could represent this as with one feature based on if the skill in the query is Java, then you have another feature that says if the job title in the document contains the word Java, then give it a higher score than when the job title in the document does not contain the word Java. But as you can imagine, this if you would continue with this approach like this, so if you would graph features like this, you will get like an explosion of different features, because here it's only about Java, but you would also want to do it for other skills, right? So you will end up with a massively large feature vector, which makes it unable for you to learn anything, because the number of features should never be greater than the number of learning instances. So a better approach is to try to already craft kind of generic features, such as this one. It's like, does the job title contain a word from the skill? Well, this means you have to do a bit more complicated construction of the features, but it's not very more costly, and in the end, it's it generalizes way better, but it's also easier for the algorithm, as you see, to learn something, because now it only has to make like one split, and before it had to make two splits. So this is another example about experience years. I just included this to show that the decision trees are not really well equipped to deal with like linear dependencies. As you see, there are many splits needed to learn that there's some kind of linear dependency between education and years of experience. But eventually, it can be learned. It just requires more splits than categorical dependencies. So the question is, did it work? For us, yes. So we tried, as I said already, we tried with this re-ranking with this linear model, but also with two decision tree-based models. One is LambdaMart, and the other is Random Forest, which basically use LambdaMart as a submodel. As I said, with the linear model, the average increase in energy D was plus 6%. And with two other decision tree models, where one was an increase of 16% relative to the baseline, where the baseline is no re-ranking at all. And the other decision tree-based model had an energy D increase of 22%, which is, pretty good. One thing I want to say about these scores is that, so these scores reported on the previous slide are basically averaged over all queries, right? But it can also be useful to see how robust your ranking model is, because maybe it only improves certain queries and not others. Like maybe you get an average increase, but it's only based on a few queries that are have improved performance, while a lot of other queries have slightly declined performance. So, in this graph, you see on the horizontal axis, you see the NSGG score from 0 on the left to 1 on the right, which is like binned in intervals of 0.1. And then on the vertical axis, you see the number of queries. And the red bars represent the number of queries of the baseline ranking, which is no re-ranking at all. And the blue bars represent the number of queries when we applied our re-ranking model. So you see that if you look at energy G scores from 0 to 0.1, or from 0.1 to 0.2, or from 0.2 to 0.3, you see that a lot more of the baseline, in the baseline system, a lot more queries fell into those intervals. While in the using the ranking model, a lot less. And you see that the mass of queries have shifted a bit to the right using the ranking model. But you can also see that, for example, in the NSG interval from 0.8 to 0.9, there were slightly more queries in the baseline system that fell into this interval, which is pretty high NSG score, than in the re-ranking model. But in general, the mass has shifted to the right, and there are not really a lot of weird outliers. So I'm just going to briefly going to say something about the execution time. So we tested it by applying re-ranking on the top 100 documents with 1 million documents, and our model had like 1,000 tweets where each had maximum 7 leaves. We also used like the barely altered RankLib library, where we got an increase of 22% in average query execution time, which was a few hundred milliseconds. But this basically was only due to translation of the API object, so not even due to the feature extraction or model application, but basically because by default in RankLib, it expects like a string of features, which it then internally parses and translate to sort of a data point object with a float of features. So this was very costly for us. But once we removed this, we only got like average query execution time increase of 4%, just only a few tens of milliseconds, which was, is really minimal for us. Okay, finally, I'm going to say something about our next steps that we're working on. It's basically implicit user feedback gathering. So instead of collecting explicit feedback, which we've done so far, we gather implicit feedback from how our users interact with our search interface. So the thing is that we have a lot of different, we have quite a lot of different customers, and these customers all have different users, and we have a lot of different actions, like you can email a candidate, you can save a candidate in a project, you can print a candidate, you can open their CV, etc. So the question is how to transform these user actions to feedback signals. And this can be sort of a classification model, but it's very likely to be different per customer, right? So that's important to keep in mind. Another thing important to keep in mind is to avoid modeling an action loop. Well, of course, you can have like a system where you directly record the conversion of a customer. So if you want to optimize that conversion action, I mean, that's a good idea, right? But we don't have such an action because we cannot log if somebody is eventually hired or not. We can only log like all other kinds of actions. So when we create like a re-ranking model based on implicit feedback, we always validate it with our human-made assessments to make sure we're not just modeling an action loop, like putting the clicked documents higher without actually improving the ranking. And another thing I want to say is to avoid modeling a reinforcing feedback loop. So that, yeah, you know probably about position bias. So documents that are on top are often clicked more often. There's also something called selection bias, which means that if the relevant document is so low, then very low, then because of position bias, it's never clicked. So the query has no clicks and doesn't enter the training set at all. So your training set is basically skewed. Well, these are all things that should be dealt with, but I'm not going into details about that right now. I don't really have time anymore. So to jump to the conclusions, I would want to say first that faceted search can be improved by LTR, as we have shown, and it doesn't have to hinder your execution times. But it helps to determine sort of your learning objectives and choose the features and the algorithm accordingly and also in harmony with each other. And keep in mind that the ranking models aren't static. So they differ in performance per query type and user, and you'll likely have to retrain them or like Grant said in his talk, you have to apply some filter beforehand to see which model to select, which model you use, depending on the product category or user, for example. Well, thanks.
We have questions in the audience. There's one back on the left side.
Thanks for the talk. You did say you wouldn't want to go into what you do to avoid the feedback loop, the reinforcing feedback loop. But since we have some time, I was hoping maybe you could go into it a little bit.
How to deal with position bias. One thing, there are a lot of papers about that, and we haven't really decided on an approach that we use. But one thing you can, for example, do is to, you can include the original position in the when you train a model, but set the position to zero when you apply a model, and that way, all documents will be treated as on position one. So you're supposed to not have that bias then anymore. How to deal with the selection bias is much more difficult. There are methods for that, but it's a bit hard to explain it right now in all details.
All right. If there are no further questions, then let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.